I am African American.
I am a member of the United States Air Force.
I am a Christian.
I am positive.
I am disabled.
I am a biochemist.
I am democratic.
I am adopted.
I am pagan.
I am a leader.
I'm a mother.
I'm politically independent.
I'm a world traveler.
I am Muslim.
I'm biracial.
I'm 19.
I'm an activist.
I am Canadian.
We are twins.
I am Ferris.
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 When I first got to Ferris, someone told me that they knew this woman who collected racist memorabilia. And I went to her home to visit her. She at first didn't want me to see the material because she assumed I was going to want it. I promised her that I wasn't going to want it, but of course I did. Eventually, she allowed me to see the collection. It was in a barn, and it was shelves full of every conceivable racist object you could imagine. It took away my breath. And I remember thinking that day, I need to create something like this, but in an academic setting. And that was the day I decided that the collection that I had, which had just been objects used for visual aids and presentations, could be something greater than that. It could actually be a museum. And I began the process of trying to build that museum at Ferris State.
David was hired to a tenure track position at Ferris. I was his supervisor, and when we met the first time to talk about developing his plan for how he was going to get tenure over the next 5 years, he mentioned that he had a collection of racist memorabilia that he'd really like to be able to use for teaching purposes.
Well, we had a group in arts and sciences, and it expanded beyond that, called Diversity Counts. And it was during that time, as I recall, that we made arrangements. We were to have a place to display David's collection.
We could see that there was something really to offer, and that people had real deep human experiences.
Very early on, we realized that we were not serving anywhere near as many students as we should be.
The museum needed more space, and that even though it was a start and we were in one room, a small room at that, that a larger story, I think, could be told.
It didn't give visitors any sense of the response of the African American community in the face of Jim Crow.
The old museum, everything is cluttered together, and even though we tried to arrange it thematically, and that you really can't have the impact that you should have in a proper museum presentation.
It wasn't, you know, more than a few months after we opened the facility and realized how powerful that facility was, that we started thinking, you know, we have to design not visible storage room, but a real museum exhibit that, you know, was self-directed.
The key reason for building the museum is that many people think that racism and a lot of the issues associated with it are behind us.
Americans have a difficult time, even in these days, talking about race. For many Americans, they believe that racism is something that will go away if you just stop talking about it.
So many people think because we have a black president now that everything's in the past. But as you've seen, it's kind of more overt than it used to be.
So it's something that we need to teach our history, and not only just for white students, for everybody, to see what has transpired, and not that long ago.
A lot of times we think a lot of these things that we talk about when we talk about racism or intolerance, we think it happened so long ago. And as Dr. Pilgrim has alluded to on many occasions, a lot of the artifacts that he collects are being created today.
These images are still out there, and that folks don't get that this may be demeaning or this is representative of an era that we should be past, but it's still out there.
The message of the Jim Crow Museum is much more than the relationships between blacks and whites. It's the history of man's intolerance towards his fellow man. And you can apply this to any type of segregation in any country, and I think you can learn from that, not just from what happened in our country, but what might happen across the world.
It's our job as people coming from elsewhere to sort of broaden people's experience beyond what they would get generally in their cultural upbringing.
For people to have a deeper appreciation of our history and knowing that it was ugly and it was hard, but that, you know, in 2012 we can make a difference.
It provides a means of getting people to talk about race. And as part of that process, though, it also points out to people that racism still exists, and therefore we have to talk about it. We can't just pretend that not talking about it makes it go away.
We have an opportunity here. We still live in a racist society. We still live in a sexist society. We've come a long way, but we have a long way to go. And so I think this museum will be a great way to teach tolerance.
We would be naive to think that there still aren't current issues that we deal with on a day-to-day basis when it comes to diversity, when it comes to racism. So having it, I think, will ultimately, you can only hope that it will break those barriers, it will get people to have more conversations.
It matters that we know how to talk about race. We talk about it without talking about it. We have conversations where we're uncomfortable, and because it's uncomfortable, we stop talking about it. And we have to keep talking about it. We can't just let it go. You know, racism isn't going to go away by being silent.
This museum gives an opportunity to educate everyone, you know, not just one particular ethnic group, but everyone in regards to where we've been and where we need to go in the future.
The museum will appeal to a much wider audience than simply the student population, and my hope is that the museum will make Ferris State University a destination.
I was on campus when Martin Luther King was assassinated, when Bobby Kennedy was assassinated, and when the students at Kent State were killed. And so I lived through the civil rights movement itself, and to see something like this now on campus, a teaching tool of this magnitude, because I've been fighting for fairness and equality up here for over 40 years. And I think this museum will aid in those efforts. And so after 40 some years doing this, I'm so excited to be on the board at this historic time.
And it is such a triumph for our university to have this collection here. I'm hopeful that this new home will allow the museum to continue to grow and impact on many, many more students and citizens throughout Michigan and throughout our area.
And so we have every reason to celebrate this being it's an achievement, but it also is a way for all of us to participate in what can be done when people focus around a project that matters so much and ends up providing the community with so much.
Hopefully it just gives people a little bit more insight and motivation to make it better and to teach others what it is, especially when they leave Ferris. And I think that that's one of the things that can definitely change the world once they leave Ferris. Because if you know something and you're able to understand it and you were educated about it, you can definitely go back and articulate it to somebody else.
Everyone that's involved with this museum believes in its necessity. And its power, its ability to be an incredible resource for not just Ferris, not just Michigan, but the country and even the world. I really believe that that is the accomplishment of this museum, is to get that dialogue going and keep going and confront people where they're at and make them think.
This museum really helps people build understanding. And we're going to graduate citizens who are prepared for a world that's different than the world that you and I grew up in. I can't think any better way to teach understanding, to teach an appreciation of differences than walking through the Jim Crow Museum and considering the exhibits and considering what the message is for us today as we grapple with the challenges we have in terms of equality and treating all races and all people as our brothers and sisters.
It's very moving every time I go in there, and I'm so excited about when we have it completely done, because I'll probably be moved to tears when I walk in there.
The museum is like a gift, isn't it? And what I hope for it to accomplish isn't any different than what I experienced it accomplishing on the day-to-day level when I work closely with the museum. It changes people's minds. It changes their hearts. It hurts them. It gives them a reason to think through the hurt. It's not a matter of what I hope will happen. It's what happens in the museum. It always has. It always will. It changed minds. So it's kind of it's wonderfully endless what it's capable of doing.
You know, I think big, and at the risk of sounding immodest, I want Ferris State University and the Jim Crow Museum to be centers for national dialogues about race, race relations, and racism. I want people coming here from all over, scholars coming from all over, students who are beginning their study of these topics to come here. I want people, when they're at Harvard and Princeton and Brown, when they think about race or they're talking about race, to wonder what the people at Ferris State University are talking about.
You know, it's amazing to see how far the Jim Crow Museum has come. From a room and upstairs of STAR to now, you know, being on such a grand scale of engagement and invisibility.
These many years later, to see this realized, that this is what it was all about, is both humbling and gratifying. And I can hardly talk about it without, quite frankly, just wanting to cry.
But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Oh, there've been times that I thought I couldn't last for long, but now I think I'm able to carry. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come.